3 in stereo. The time is 6:15. We're broadcasting now a performance of Janacek's opera Osud, in an English version by Jean Eisler, with Gregory Dempsey as Zivny, the late Marie Collier as Mila, and Anne Howard as Mila's mother. The Orpington Junior Singers, trained by Sybil Bell, the BBC Chorus, and the BBC Concert Orchestra, leader Arthur Levins. The conductor is Vilém, Tauský. The performance was recorded before an invited audience in our Camden studios in October 1971 and first broadcast in January 72. Osud, or Fate, was Janacek's fourth opera. It was written just after Yennefer during the years 1904 to 1906, when he was in his mid-50s, but though he revised it subsequently, it didn't reach the stage until 1958, 30 years after his death, when it was given performances at Brno and Stuttgart. The opera was originally based on an episode in the composer's life, and though finally the autobiographical element was removed, the character of Zivny has all the intensity of a self-portrait. In the present version, the main part of the story is presented as a flashback between prologue and epilogue. The curtain rises on the concert hall of a conservatoire, where a number of music students are rehearsing an opera by the composer Zivny. They've just reached the final scene where the hero Lensky dies during a thunderstorm, a very curious ending, so they think. As they all relax and begin to enjoy themselves, the conductor, Verva, calls for silence. He tells them that the opera is really about Zivny himself and his love affair with a certain Mila Valkova. Catching sight of Doubek, Zivny's son, he breaks off for a moment. But he can't resist playing to them part of the duet sung in the opera by Mila and her child. During this time, Zivny himself has entered. Verva asks him to explain the story of his opera. Zivny replies enigmatically that he knew Lensky personally, a sensitive, passionate soul. On the day that he met Mila, his life was transformed. But Mila's mother contrived to separate them. She poisoned Zivny's mind against her daughter, who was now carrying his child. A few years later, the lovers met by chance at a spa. Here, an interlude takes us back in time to the events which Zivny is about to narrate. It's a very warm, sunny afternoon. Visitors to the spa are taking the air and exchanging remarks about the weather. Among them are Mila and her mother, and three acquaintances, Lhotsky, Konecny, and Dr. Suda. The mother stops for a little conversation with the mayor's wife, whereupon Lhotsky presents Mila with a bouquet of roses. But these only make her think of Zivny. Then suddenly, she catches sight of him walking alone. He's also recognized by Konecny, an old friend of his, who insists on introducing him to the rest of the company. Noticing the tension between Mila and Zivny, the other three men tactfully withdraw. After a few words together, the two lovers stroll towards the park as a group of schoolgirls burst in on the scene with their teacher, who's trying vainly to keep order. Lhotsky and Suda return in a festive mood and improvise a procession with flags and bunting in which crowds of young people join. Madame Valkova appears briefly, searching for her daughter. Then, as the procession marches away into the park, Mila and Zivny return and tell each other of their unhappiness since being apart. They decide to run away together. Meanwhile, dusk has fallen. Lhotsky, Suda, and the followers have drifted back. Konecny is flirting with one of the schoolmistresses. The hotel visitors are returning indoors. But the disappearance of Mila and Zivny has not gone unnoticed. When Madame Valkova comes back asking where her daughter is, the mayor's wife is only too happy to tell her. Far away, the voice of a student is heard pleading with his girlfriend. And the curtain falls on the black fury of Mila's mother.
Thank you. performance tonight. We
of unhappiness, for no response in any heart. But suddenly a change took place within him. Some said that he now at last had fallen in love.
left her terrified and shaken. A faded flower whose bloom is dashed by the elements. And Lensky. And Lensky.
Once again. One fine summer. hoping that you may deign to take them.
What is the matter, my dear? What is distressing you so? Is that she, the composer?
Tell her in love and first. here, good friend. Come and join us.
How kind of you. I am delighted. My name is Zivny.
This, my lady, if you'll permit me.
Oh, thank you, Sophia.
Zivny, the composer, Dr. Suda.
Some say composer.
Oh, come, why this modesty? Why so doubting?
Should there not be something more? Since all my music sings of true love's language.
True love's language.
True love's language.
The language of jealousy and false perfidious passion.
Thank you. Oh, come, let us go now.
Oh,
That's the end of Act One of Janacek's opera, Osud. It's a recording of a studio performance in which Gregory Dempsey sings the part of Zivny, the late Marie Collier is Mila, and Anne Howard is Mila's mother, with the Orpington Junior Singers, the BBC Chorus, and the BBC Concert Orchestra. The conductor is Vilém, Tauský. The introduction to the second act will follow in a quarter of an hour at 25 to 8. During the interval, Stephen Dodgson talks about Osud and its place in Janacek's works for the stage.
So much does one think of Janacek belonging to the 20th century, it needs an effort to remind oneself that he lived much more than half his life in the last one. And it isn't just because of musical style that Janacek is essentially a 20th century composer, but for the simple reason that all the music by which he is remembered was written after 1900. And, with the single exception of Yennefer, all his really celebrated pieces were composed in the last 12 years of his life, between 1916 and his death in 1928. The only comparable case that comes to mind of a tremendous creative personality erupting in a volcanic activity in old age is Domenico Scarlatti. And the similarity goes some way if we think about it. Scarlatti, like Janacek, had been an extremely accomplished composer from his youth, relatively conventional and unremarkable perhaps, but much respected. And in both cases, when the personal style did emerge, it proved to be a thing apart from the age in which it happened, and full of a youthful, fiery passion not normally associated with 60-year-olds. Janacek's early music isn't played, or at least I've not heard it, but I have seen it. A 7-movement suite for string orchestra, for instance, written when he was about 22. It has an obvious antecedent in Dvorak's E major serenade. It's a bit long, but otherwise I can't see why some of our many chamber orchestras don't play it, for it has melodic and rhythmic charm, and the players would undoubtedly like it, for the writing is graceful and accomplished. And the fact is that it very likely might be played if we didn't at once react to the idea of music by Janacek, which doesn't sound in the least like Janacek. Domenico Scarlatti, I think you'll agree, is a like case. Those 550 sonatas are so replete with energy and character, it's enough. And the Janacek of the operas, of the two string quartets, the Glagolithic Mass, the Sinfonietta, the Diary of One Who Vanished, is such an overwhelming force, so far above the rather self-conscious posturing of much 20th century music, that most of us, myself certainly, don't want to meet him with that blazing character watered down, or worse, not in evidence at all. And I have to admit that in thinking about Osud, my imagination is rather prone to jump to Yennefer, its companion piece and immediate predecessor. For in every page of Yennefer, the Janacek character burns with a conspicuous brightness which Osud only attains fitfully and never with anything like the same dramatic force. Yennefer has a very good libretto, and Osud a rather bad one, which does partly account for the reduced dramatic impact. But simply in terms of musical idiom, Osud is much less developed, less far along the road towards the later operas. And if nothing was known about their order of composition, I feel sure the common informed guess would put Osud well before Yennefer. Janacek himself doesn't seem to have been aware that the two operas weren't of the same artistic calibre, but he campaigned almost harder for a production of Osud than he did for Yennefer. That campaigning period was the least productive part of his life, and I suggest there may be a connection there. But it's interesting that even after the eventual production of Yennefer in 1916, Janacek continued to mull over the prospects of Osud until the last 5 operas from Mr. Brocek onward presumably made it take an increasingly back seat. But if he cared for Osud at least equally with Yennefer, Janacek was never wholly satisfied with its libretto. And what is being broadcast now is a version, that's to say, a form in which Janacek might finally have left the opera if a performance had actually materialized in his lifetime. In fact, with the musical material he had, I don't see he could have hit on a better solution than the flashback technique which was adopted for the first performances in Brno and Stuttgart in 1958, and which is being followed in this broadcast. for the whole dramatic significance of Osud seems to be that you can't really tell the story within the story, part from part. An opera about an opera composer at work on an opera about himself. That, in a nutshell, is the plot. And as soon as you investigate the sources of the story, you quickly see that Osud's hero, called Lhotsky in the finished opera, and Zivny, when he's living the story as its composer, has still a third name, which is none other than Leos Janacek. There are two points here. First, what prompted Janacek to pick such an unpromising story in the first place? And second, how much does it affect one's appreciation of the work if you have understandable difficulty separating the various layers of reality and make-believe? Lhotsky acting the part of Zivny with Janacek breathing down his neck. And on this second point, I may as well say at once that as Janacek has clearly not attempted to define these layers, it seems to me he cannot have wanted them to be definite. For he certainly had the musical and dramatic technique to be very defined when he wished. This is why I like the flashback technique of this broadcast version. It avoids urging definition upon a work which has so obviously resisted it. We drift from the present into the past and gradually come forward to the present again, by which time the two realities are blurred together. But before I go any deeper into this rather confusing business and its musical result, and the way in which the music itself aids the confusion, I'll try to deal briefly with a slightly easier first point, the autobiographical element. I remember being ticked off a few years ago for suggesting, in a radio talk like this, that Janacek's celebrated affair in later life with Kamila Stuhlá had some bearing on his creative impetus, and in particular that the guilt complex so prominent in the emotional climate of the diary of Katya Kabanova and of the both the string quartets might have achieved its musical realization because the composer knew these feelings all too well himself. Despite being ticked off, I still cannot rid myself of the sensation of strong autobiographical connection here. After all, one can be profoundly impressed by Tolstoy's novel The Kreutzer Sonata without having to mention its title in connection with the string quartet. And the background to Osud does positively show how Janacek was the imaginative type to project himself into his own works of art. What Berlioz often pretended to do, Janacek actually did, unadvertised. Janacek had a daughter called Olga, of whom he was exceptionally fond. She was often ill in adolescence and died in 1902, aged 20, just as Janacek was finishing Yennefer. He dedicated the opera to her memory, and also in her memory wrote an elegy for tenor solo, chorus and piano. One of Olga's great interests had been in the Russian language, and Janacek was obviously still obsessed with thoughts about her when finding someone to write the libretto of Osud for him. For the task went to a friend of Olga's, a young schoolteacher called Fedora Bartoshova, and she was instructed to write the libretto in Pushkinesque verse, the outline of the story being provided by the composer. The story seems to have occurred to him whilst staying at the fashionable Moravian spa Luhachovice in the summer of 1903, trying to recover after Olga's death. There he met a Mrs. Kamila Uralkova, who, so she told him, had been depicted as a flirtatious girl in a one-act opera by Chelansky called Kamila. Perhaps Janacek could set the record straight in another opera and show, on the contrary, her fineness of character. It doesn't seem too likely a story, but it does have a strong resemblance to the act of Osud which has just finished. She's not Kamila in Osud, but Mila. And no difficulty in recognizing that fashionable crowd, its social manners and its distractions, and Janacek's Mila always full of higher sensibility, anything but a flirt. One of Janacek's many vacillations over the plot included a scene where Zivny, the composer, suffers the rejection of his score by an opera house. That, too, has rather an autobiographical ring. But perhaps the strongest reason of all for thinking Osud is deeply personal and much associated with grief for Olga is its distinct sentimentality. It's not at all like Janacek to be sentimental, but the flavour is unmistakable in Osud. It's more than having a story like an old film. Givny, that special, improbable kind of celluloid composer, a bit of a drip, and always full of melodramatic heartbreak over his scores. There's every reason why Janacek should have worked upon the characterization of Mila's mother of them all. It could have helped the dramatic conviction of the plot no end if her madness and evil blight upon the lovers were lit with some of the spine-chilling portraiture you find in Yennefer. But no. In the next scene, you hear her calling fate, fate, amidst her offstage mockery of the lovers. But the music does nothing to develop her as a person, with the result that she doesn't feel so much like Mila's mother as some chilly impersonation of unavoidable nemesis arrived from below, and in that genre, far less credible than Don Giovanni's unwelcome guest. Givny and Mila speak with other characters, but these are indeterminate beings passing by without their features making any impression. Janacek's whole concentration goes on the unlucky pair. This is a sentimental idea in itself, it seems to me, or at any rate, I think it helps explain the musical nature of Osud and why it is so much softer, so much more sustained than Yennefer, to say nothing of the cryptic and often explosive style of the later operas. For the most part in Osud, you find a broadly sonorous spacing for the orchestra, the very opposite of that grainy, holes-in-the-middle manner which gives later Janacek his special orchestral sound. In Osud, the harmonies and figuration are actually more Janacekian in idiom than you might perhaps realize to start with, but you're deceived because of the sonorous, blended orchestration. Then there are the vocal lines. Osud abounds in sostenuto writing, which often continues for long stretches uninterrupted by Janacek's parlando speech rhythm technique, which is so much to the fore in the later operas. In a sense, Osud is more singer's music than those later operas are. The rewards for a soprano faced with portraying the vixen in The Cunning Little Vixen are certainly not vocal. The part is often awkward vocally, and the rewards are dramatic and in characterization. You could almost say of Mila's part, on the other hand, that dramatically it's not particularly interesting, but that vocally it has much that's very beautiful. In fact, in the Luhachovice scene just now, I catch an occasional aroma of Puccini, alongside the more expected echoes of Smetana and Dvorak in the dance music and the charming noisy crocodile of schoolgirls. Yennefer, if you remember, has a lot of dance music and choral reverie in the first scene outside the mill, the drunken Stever and the recruits. But how wild that dancing and singing compared with the polite, well-mannered folk at the spa. So that even apart from the way in which the principal characters are depicted in the two operas, the way the chorus and supporting cast behave in Osud does tend to produce a kind of bourgeois sentimental border to the portrait of the lovers in the middle. For listeners joining at this point, some of the foregoing remarks may seem a little strange, especially the bit about occasional reminders of Puccini and the generally not very dominant presence of an obviously Janacek idiom. Because the very next thing that happens, the prelude to the second act, growing from a spiny little ascending scale motif, is very characterful. And though the succeeding scene, Givny musing upon his nearly completed score, is less so, at any rate at first, the vocal lines begin to acquire contours more typical of Janacek as Givny remembers how he had doubted Mila's constancy to him during their long separation. Though it's actually the mother, with her words, "Let me be, for I'm not crazy," repeated a time or two shortly before the fateful double death, which is perhaps the most unmistakably Janacek fingerprint in the whole scene. There's also a strong ending to the act, Givny expecting the hand of fate to strike him dead too, characteristic of Janacek in being quite brief, and the more intense for being brief.
That was Stephen Dodgson. And now we go back to the second act of Janacek's opera, Osud. A few years have passed. Mila and Zivny have married and are living together with their son, Doubek, now a boy of about 10. Givny is looking through the pages of his opera, watched by Mila. "It's finished," he says, "but in a sense, it can have no real ending." He had written it after their first separation as a bitter indictment of the woman whom he believed wrongly to have betrayed him. Mila tries to comfort him, but they're continually interrupted by the mocking voice of Madame Valkova from the next room. Since their marriage, she has become mentally deranged. Little Doubek comes running in. He'd like his mother to tell him what love is. But of course he knows the answer already. It's how the servants, Jan and Jenny, love each other. Mila, half amused, half crying, sends him away. Just then her mother appears at the door carrying her box of jewels. Neither Zivny nor Mila shall inherit a penny from her, she cries. That will teach her daughter to marry a worthless composer. She makes as if to hurl the box at Zivny. Mila drags her out of the room to the balcony. There's a brief struggle, and mother and daughter fall to their deaths. Doubek returns in time to see his mother's body being carried in by Zivny. An interlude takes us back to the opening scene in the theatre. Zivny has finished his story, but the strain of telling it has proved too great for him. In a delirium, he seems to see a vision of Mila, and he collapses in a faint. Verva and Kosinska do what they can to revive him, and as he's about to be led away by Doubek, Verva murmurs that this is perhaps the real end of the opera. No, replies Zivny faintly. The ending is in the hands of God.
Thank you.
my deepest agony. I'll play you just once more. When riot is a parting, now and forever,
Oh, betrayal and jealousy, poisoning my heart of soul. I meant to tear the heart from your bosom, point it to its searing finger, and with derision ring out my hatred. Told you till your spirit would drown in tears, then flayed by the lash of remorse you'd be driven to take your own life. Embraces, those words of endearment, those smiles and kisses.
Thank you. weeping. You hear it, surely?
Maybe this is the ending of the opera.
Ending to the opera. That is in the hands of God and for him to reveal.
That's the end of Janacek's opera, Osud, which was first broadcast in January last year. The libretto, by Fedora Bartoshova, was translated by Jean Eisler. This was the cast. Zivny, Gregory Dempsey. Mila, Marie Collier. Mila's mother, Anne Howard. Verva, Neil Howlett. Lhotsky and Suda, Roland Jones. Konecny, Gordon Farrell. Lhotsky, William Elvin. Kosinska, Wendy Baldwin. An old Slovak woman, Yvonne Newman. The mayor's wife, Veronica Lucas. A schoolteacher, Wendy Baldwin. A young girl, Anne Rowley. A student, Emlyn Jones. Doubek, Michael Nichols, and a schoolgirl, Anne Rowley, with the Orpington Junior Singers, trained by Sybil Bell, the BBC Chorus, and the BBC Concert Orchestra, leader Arthur Levins, conducted by Vilém Tauský. The repetiteur was Martin Penny, and the opera was produced by Julian Button.